Okay, first thing, let's do some housekeeping. So this is going to be a two-parter. It was going to be a one-parter because I really just wanted to do a show about the various representations of a particularly long-lived pop cultural figure in certain media, but it wound up requiring enough historical and cultural context that it was clear that part warranted an episode of its own. So there's that. Long story short, this is going to be a little on the dense side, but I hope you find it interesting. All the way into the 21st century, Satan, aka the devil, is probably the single most prominent visual shorthand for evil incarnate on the planet. Though only native to a relative few world religions, the devil's ubiquitous presence in popular culture, from movies to music to video games to cartoons to a whole bunch of stuff we'll talk about next week, means that damn near everybody could probably draw you a pretty spot-on version just from memory, probably only needing two crayons. But where does the devil, as he or occasionally she is conceived in the worldwide pop culture stew, come from? Most folks would probably say the Bible, duh, and they'd be right. But also not. See, a figure alternately referred to as Satan or the devil does figure into both the traditional Christian and Jewish religious text, but he's not necessarily prominent in either one of them. In the ancient Hebrew Bible, or Tanakh, a Satan is only mentioned a little over a dozen times and only about twice by that name originally. The others are cryptic anonymous references to an enemy, adversary, or some other sinister force that were re-specified to Satan by various later translation of the texts, mainly by Greek, Roman, and medieval Western European translators. Taken as a singular character, this Satan is more of a designated deceiver and, well, pain in the butt of mankind, similar to trickster god figures like Loki in other ancient traditions. In Christianity, on the other hand, Satan is way more specifically important, but again, not quite so much in the letter of the text. Jesus Christ is tempted by a demonic figure in 3 out of 4 canonical gospel accounts, but the name Satan is only used once. Christ also confronts other demons in various accounts said to either be Satan himself or in allegiance to the same, but the bottom line is the two of them just aren't really going at it all Batman versus the Joker anywhere in the actual text. Instead, the devil, as active, prominent nemesis of all things good, is largely the product of extra-biblical lore largely originating in medieval Christianity, where until the invention of the printing press, both the preaching and the interpretation of scripture was all but exclusively in the hands of priests and or religious scholars, and it was in this milieu that Satan as pop culture knows him today was largely shaped, or, depending on your point of view, divined. It was here that he gained an origin story, namely being the depowered and debased form of an otherwise biblically obscure fallen angel named Lucifer, was decided, or again depending on perspective, discovered to be the serpent in the Garden of Eden, and was finally postulated to be the mastermind behind the murderer's row of demons, beasts, and sundry bad actors destined to menace the world in the apocalypse described in the Book of Revelation. It was also in this period that the most famous visual ideas of the character took shape, since his appearance is never actually mentioned in any text. Now, medieval artists got ridiculously creative when it came to depicting Satan, but the most prominent stuff that hangs around today, like cloven hooves, horns, trident, goat parts, etc., are largely drawn from references to pre-existing pagan deities of the time, with many scholars positing that this was done deliberately to further discredit rival faiths. Oh, this is also where the accusation of folks practicing Satan worship first took real shape, was conflated with the historically nebulous concept of witchcraft, and began the first of many flare-ups of witch hunt hysteria. That'll be important to remember very shortly. And after that? Well, after that, full-on acknowledged fiction writers took over. Almost every depiction of Satan as anything other than simply evil incarnate descends directly from John Milton's Paradise Lost, which fleshed out the Lucifer origin and cast the devil as a tragic, almost sympathetic figure, while most conceptions of hell, which also owes more to extra-biblical extrapolation than to scripture, and Satan's place therein still draws from Dante's Inferno. After that, decades on into centuries of art, music, theater, literature, and yes, ongoing evolution of religious canon, refine and polish the collective idea of the devil. And then in the early 20th century, things got all shook up. You remember those witch hunts against supposed human followers of Satan I mentioned a moment ago? Well, throughout the years, various dissenting voices had questioned or outright alleged that such purges were actually the persecution of surviving adherents to pre-Christian pagan religions native to Western Europe. But since pre-Christian Europe wasn't exactly known for its record-keeping, this was always kind of difficult to prove. But in 1921, pioneering Egyptologist and anthropologist Margaret Murray published The Witch Cult in Western Europe, in which she theorized that the early church labeled devil worship was actually a once-thriving, unified, continent-wide pagan religion centered on the nature worship and a horned god, whose image the church appropriated and corrupted into the medieval Satan. Murray's work here was unprecedented in its thoroughness and collected a lot of once-thought-unrelated dots, but her ultimate conclusions, to say nothing of some questionable methodology, are not well thought of by most modern scholarship on the subject, though it did directly inspire many later, more definitive explorations. But her impact on popular culture was immeasurable. The basics of her witch cult hypothesis were the inciting spark for a groundswell of New Age spiritual and philosophical movements that thrive today in the form of neo-pagan sects like Wicca. But, more pertinent to this discussion, the pagan and neo-pagan witchcraft iconography Murray's work popularized into the mainstream consciousness were quickly reappropriated by horror movies, comics, pulp novels, etc., but largely with the satanic implications still intact, transforming devil worshippers and satanic cults into the new ready-made bad guys du jour of religiously inflected scary fiction for decades to come. However, this fascination with devil worship came to a disastrous head in 1980 with the publication of a smash hit book called Michelle Remembers, in which psychiatrist Lawrence Pazder claimed to have recovered repressed memories in his wife and patient, Michelle, detailing horrific abuse as a child by her parents as part of rituals for what she alleged was a worldwide, highly organized, centuries-old satanic cult. The book and its authors were picked up by the talk show circuit, creating a national frenzy of accusations and conspiracy theories, now dubbed the Satanic Panic, and associated with everything from the moral assaults on Dungeons and Dragons to the arrest of the West Memphis Three. You still see plenty of movies and such with Satanist villains like the recent flop Devil's Due, but not nearly as many as you did for a while there. Oh, and the book? Well, it seems like they made it up. I mean, there's never been any charges or anything, but it seems like a complete fabrication. No one has ever managed to corroborate any of this. It was kind of a big scandal for a while. And yeah, that's about how far I can condense the origins of the devil in popular culture to under 6 minutes or so. Next week, we'll lighten things up a bit and see how pop culture, geeky pop culture in particular, has made use of this rich tapestry of influences and traditions. I'm Bob, and that's the big picture.